so it's Friday, November 20th, and we're here at Moses Studio with Rani Singh, Andrew Perchuk, Peter Kirby, Morgan Kessler, Lucy Bradnock, and Ed Moses. And Ed, I told you what we were going to talk about a little today, you know, not only your upbringing and your work, but also what the scene was like in Los Angeles during the 50s and 60s. So maybe we can start off a little bit about giving us, you can tell us a little bit about your early childhood and where you were born.
Okay. I was born on a ship sailing from Hawaii to San Pedro. My father was importing Kona coffee. And we got in a big storm, so I was slightly premature. We got held up 4 or 5 days because of the storm. And I was signed up in Long Beach, I think, for my papers. And apparently if you're wherever you're sailing to would be the place that you would have your birth. And that was in 1926. And we lived in Long Beach for 2 years while my dad was trying to sell coffee. He had no luck. He was a very successful businessman and lost everything in Hawaii. He was not Hawaiian, he was from Nova Scotia. And he was teaching English. And Joseph Conrad was his favorite writer. And he wrote about the Sandwich Islands. So my dad decided with a pal of his to take off and have an adventure. He was tired of teaching English. He was in his 20s. And he lit in Hawaii in 1900, I think. And to Large Island. And he opened a series of stores, dry goods stores. And he was not a natural businessman. He was very poetic in nature, rather grand and elegant. And he looked like Winston Churchill, sounded like when he was 5 foot tall and 5 foot wide. And it was an arranged marriage. My mother had nothing to do. She just finished the Sacred Heart Academy in Honolulu. And she was Portuguese. Her had to be the queen and ran the whole all her sisters and brothers and everybody have to take her direction. So she had a son. He died of pneumonia when he was 6. She had another son, John, my older brother, and he died when he was 14 due to leakage of the heart, and I was the sole survivor. And I was a real problem in school. I couldn't learn. So my mother was going with some college guy and they set up an IQ test and discovered I was a moron. I heard him talking in the other room because I couldn't read. Just couldn't read. The teachers always said he's smart, but I don't know what the problem is. I was great at oral. Talking. I don't know where I got information because I couldn't read. So anyway, we lived there and then we went back to Hawaii. In the meantime, while my mother was out, she met a gambler that had the gambling boats 20 miles off San Pedro and took up with him. And then so we all went back to Hawaii, my older brother, myself. And my mother made some excuse. She had to come back and close the house and the antiques and all that. So we came back and she wrote my dad a Dear John and hooked up with this gambler. That lasted 6 months. And she got pregnant. There was an abortion. I remember all hearing that, but I didn't know what it meant. I just knew that there was a lot of blood around. And my mother had a very short wick. And so I was a problem. So my older brother lived with my dad in Hawaii and I lived with my mother in Long Beach. Then every summer I would spend with my dad, my older brother in Hawaii. I took up surfing in 1938. Duke Kamanamoku, took me out on an outrigger, and my dad asked, would you show the kid how to surf? So I had a huge board that weighed 100 pounds, floated about 1/8 of an inch below the surface. It was so waterlogged. It was either mahogany, I think it was mahogany, and didn't have a skag or a fin on the bottom, so it was hard to ride, but finally I learned to ride. And I never took up surfing again after the war. After we came back here, and then I joined the Navy, etc. So I was in the service for 2 years. I was a surgical technician, and my brain cut in at that time. I started reading Collier's Saturday Evening Post love stories. That was my first readings. And then later I could read technical kinds of things. And where are we now?
So you were in the Navy? And
yeah, I was a surgical technician.
I
scrubbed in with some great surgeons while I was in the Navy. So when I got out, my intention was to be a surgeon. But I had such shitty grades in junior college. I went 3 years to pre-med, and then by a fluke, met this art teacher who was very eccentric. Reminds you of Golly Jimpson in The Horse's Mouth. Alec Guinness played that part of this kooky, eccentric guy. Well, was a guy at this junior college that fit that thing, although I didn't know anything about anything like that. And everybody laughed at him. A couple of my friends were going to be in advertising art, so they said, you have to see this guy. So I went over and saw him and signed up. And I was on the GI Bill still, so I got all these art materials. And he gave us lectures about Picasso and Braque and Cézanne and things like that. And he said he hated Norman Rockwell. Nobody talked about Norman Rockwell. So then the second or third day, he had set up a still life, a la Cézanne with the horizon line bent, and said, have at it. So everybody is measuring and drawing and painting. I don't know what the hell to do. And he kept getting closer and closer. He's got almost to my easel. I dipped my fingers in these wells of different colored paints and did this finger painting as sort of a joke. I had to do something, and my friends looked over and laughed, and he got there. He looked down at that, and he looked at me, took mine off. There was a little ledge all the way around the room that you could put reproductions or whatever, and he took my little canvas and put it up there on the thing. And he said, now here's a real artist. From that day on, I was the hero in the art department. Quit pre-med, happy to quit that because that was going nowhere. You could get into Mexico with a bad grade average that I had. So, but I started painting and took theater arts, took psychology. I explored all the things I'd sign up with. 24 units every semester and end up with 4 or something like that. But I used to sit in on the lectures.
The artist was, the guy you studied with was Pedro Miller?
Yeah, Pedro Miller was his name. He was the head of the art department that, and he'd gone to the Chicago Art Institute. But he himself was a ceramicist. But he loved paintings, and he'd been exposed to all. And he talked about Giotto all the time. Giotto was his favorite, flat.
So was there a sense, you know, finding the arts that this was really part of your milieu?
No, I thought it was sort of a joke, but I didn't know what else to do. And my mother was really upset when I decided, Edward, you should have gone to medical school. Your father has set it aside. You're going to go to Stanford. Well, I couldn't get into any place. maybe not even Mexico City with the grades I had. C's, D's, F's, once in a while a B.
Med school was not in the books for you?
Pre-med was difficult, and med school would have been impossible because I couldn't memorize. I had what's called ADT now, but they didn't have a term for it there. I just couldn't learn, I couldn't memorize. To this day, I can't memorize. That's why I can't use a computer, because you have to have several things that you do, so I'd have to do it 1,000 times.
So what was the first inkling that you thought art could be?
A possibility?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. It was emerging. It was sort of faking it and then little by little getting. When I was at UCLA, I transferred to UCLA. I was in this junior college for 4 years. And then at UCLA in 1950, I got out of the service in 46. And I took sociology and psychology and anthropology as a minor.
And so were there other artists that you met, other students that you met at UCLA that were?
Yeah, the only one that was, well, Roland Reese was there at the time. He was a very talented guy. A guy named James McGarrell, who became very successful in the Middle West, he was there.
And Craig
Coffin was there. And he was there after the second year I was there, 54 or something like that. And I went on the road a lot. I hated school, and I hated the art department at UCLA. It was just a bunch of bums that were teaching there.
Who was teaching there at the time?
Stussy, Brown, Nunes. The only good guy was Bill Bryce, and he was gone part of the time, and he was great, and Lee Mulligan, but he never said much. And Diebenkorn came in, but later, after I'd left.
Was Rico Lebrun a professor?
He taught a summer class there, and I took the summer class from Rico Lebrun, and he would never talk to me, and I didn't understand why, because he was only interested in the women in the class that would buy his art and he could sleep with. So eager beavers like me, he was not interested in it at all.
And what was the style of work that was being taught there?
The style of work was a lot of paint on still lives and figures. Sort of patchy kind of painting, wasn't much good. And Craig had introduced me to the New York School, and he laughed and snickered at him all the time as being dopes. But I took off and I went to Las Vegas, and then I moved up to Carmel. I read Cannery Row and I wanted to be up there. And then I met a girl and went to Las Vegas and was lifeguard at the Flamingo Hotel for about 6 months, and then back to UCLA again. So it was intermittent at UCLA, and I couldn't graduate because I couldn't pass geometry, and I kept taking geometry over and over again. Attended this junior Santa Monica, finally passed. I think she just took pity on me, this woman that taught it.
What kind of work were you doing throughout? Were you drawing or sketching?
At that time, I started doing these kinds of paintings here. And there was a guy named Clinton Adams who did very controlled, framed things. And I think that these things were influenced by that. And this is how Venice used to be on the boardwalk. And there was one little house that was, can you see this little place? One little house with a little bird walking along it, and everything was very flat and two-dimensional. And I would move with perspective, Byzantine perspective, where you reverse the and brought everything flat. And I never could do 3D until I took Bill Bryce's class. Learn to draw a little bit around volumes with these little lines that would cage in a form or a figure. But I felt much more comfortable with flat things. Cutouts, which I'm doing now. But I paint from time to time.
So this was some of the early work that you did.
Yeah.
Was this part of the grad school work that eventually was shown at Ferris?
No. The grad school work was, I got interested in de Kooning and Resnick via reproductions and art magazines. This is one of those little drawings. Let's see.
So were you going to Gatwick, how did you see other artwork? Were you looking in books? Were your teachers teaching you? Were you going to museums?
I was looking in all the art books, Art Forum, Art News, everything. And that was in the 50s. My graduate thesis, you had to have an exhibit, usually at the university. Instead, I did it at the Ferus Gallery. That was the first one-person show I had that I listed. Earlier, I did this series of drawings here in a little gallery on San Vicente. And about 20 people came and none of them were sold.
Which gallery was that?
I can't remember the net gallery. It was a friend of mine that had the gallery. And that was about 54, something like that.
And there's a real architectural quality to those drawings.
I was interested in architecture. And at junior college, I was introduced to the Bauhaus and De Stijl and Corbusier and Mies van der Rohe. So I loved their work. And one of my alternative activities I would be architecture. And I wanted to be an architect. And then I took some architectural classes, but I realized that that would never happen. I liked to do things and I wanted it now. I didn't want to spend thousands of hours on little drawings. Although, I did do thousands of hours on these very compulsive drawings that were all about control. And while I was married, I became more and more, these are sort of architectural cutout things, and these are these rose drawings. And the rose drawings came from, I was down in Tijuana and I saw some oilcloth with roses, and I liked it. Repeat pattern, something or another, very early. I was interested in repeat patterns. And now I remember, because when I was a kid, we lived in an apartment, and my mother had a painting, and she had these drapes with flowers on them, and you could pull them out and make a little stage for this painting. And she said, "Why are you doing that, Edward?" I said, "I don't." And I was always moving the furniture around. I always like to make adjustments until I get the right thing. And that's what I do now. I make hundreds of paintings looking for the one. In the process of looking for the one, I have a whole series of paintings. A lot of them pretty interesting. A lot of them that I like. And the ones I don't like, every year, I go through and get rid of 100 paintings, just destroy them. I'm going out of context, am I not?
No, that's totally okay. We don't have to go in a linear fashion.
Okay.
That's why we have editing.
But the idea of, you know, architecture and geometry, I mean, those were some of your first drawings.
Yeah, it's funny. In geometry, I used to like to draw the structures in geometry, and I like some of the things they said, making an isosceles triangle or whatever it was, and all these various things you would do. And but I couldn't memorize the things you had to memorize. I learned a few slogans and put them in my think tank. So the think tank is full of all, like everybody, all these different factors that come in, but it's a hodgepodge.
And also at some points you know, did environmental work and architecture, whether it was, you know, designing a winery or the
right.
Rico Mizuno project.
Right, the Rico Mizuno project, the tilled up concrete walls where I had a grant to do it, and then some woman that I got involved with. You should never get involved with people you work with, because if you don't follow through, this one got vengeance. And Kashalik had set it up, and Wiseman had given the money for it, and it got sabotaged. So these big concrete walls that were going to be 50 or 60 feet high, tilled up concrete, so they would be two-dimensional with cutouts, and you'd see the environment behind them. And they were going to, when they were on the ground, I would take big mops and swab. I made a few, but they never got finished up. And then some of the concrete would erode off and break off, so you'd have these jagged edges on these big walls that would, you'd walk through.
Where was that project supposed to have been?
That was going to be in the where Disney Hall is now. On the grounds, there was a big vacant area there, and Kashalik thought that would be great. He was a big fan. And one of the few fans I had, he and Julie Brown. For a short time, there were other people.
But you've also done a lot of other environmental
decisions. Yeah, right.
There's some photographs there of the Rico Mizuno project.
Yeah, the Rico Mizuno, where I took the ceiling out to the walls up to it, and then finally cut out a section where you'd see the sky, and the sky would be like a plane. And it would be interrupted. It would just be a blue plane up there by a bird or a cloud. Suddenly it penetrated. It wasn't just a flat ceiling of blue or gray or clouds. But that was only allowed for a week because Rico was afraid she was going to lose her lease. So I had these carpenters come in, and they cut off the first layer of tar paper. And the light came through the cracks. There were boards in a diagonal patterns. And they cast shadows on the walls in the morning, and they would creep across of diagonal bands. Interesting, because I started doing these diagonal bands. Patterning. And then I took rice polishing. Whenever I'd hear somebody coming into the gallery, I'd throw them in the air so you would see the light rays. Physically, you would see light rays coming down. If you don't have dust, you can't see the light rays coming through. Later, I did a thing with a Peter Gould gallery where I did a balcony and built a false ceiling and made little holes with gels.
Tell me that Terrell was involved with that.
Yeah, Terrell helped me do the drywalling on that. And we used to have big talks because he was a very intelligent, he was a real genius type of guy. And, I said if you'd sit at the bottom of a volcano, for example, you'd have a circle around above you. And, I didn't know he'd pay any attention to that. And then he met Doug Wheeler, and Doug Wheeler introduced him to the volcano out there, showed him where it was, and got him interested in flying. But now he's a real flyer, and he takes things apart and puts them together. I guess that's going to be a fantastic situation. I was never happy with Terrell because he made a run on the person I was married to at the time, which was natural territory for him. Any woman was fair game. I'm not saying I could be critical of that.
What was the response to the Mizuno show? Was there an open, did people come? Were they?
Yeah, a lot of people were baffled by it. They just didn't understand it. And Irving Blum came down and looked at it, and John Copeland's, and they just didn't get what it was about. And I discovered it. It was just a goofy idea. The idea was at Rico Mizuno Gallery, you could do everything, including taking the roof off. And I said, taking the roof off, that's not a bad idea. And let the evil spirits out of the gallery and the light in, and just an empty space. But I did drywalls that had different heights, and there was a little slot that came in from her kitchen area. Just a little slot. I have photographs of Sam Francis and his wife on their haunches sitting in there looking at the light rays.
So did people come in and spend?
They would spend time. Some people, a lot of people off the streets were more interested in the art people.
What year was this and where was the gallery?
This was in 68 or 69, something like that. She was on La Cienega down in a long hallway. 669 North La Cienega, I remember the address of it. And she was an amazing dealer. She would let, you know, she wanted adventure.
So she was open to whatever you wanted to?
Yeah, yeah. I did the resin paintings with her. I think it was, yes, it was after that.
And the resin work, maybe we can talk a little bit about that because, you know, that was...
Well, yeah, everybody was working with plastics at the time, and I didn't like what they were doing much. Craig Kaufman was the only interesting one with the bubbles that he made. We were in a little coffee place we used to. We shared a studio on Sawtelle Boulevard many years ago, and there was this orange juice thing. It was a sphere, and the orange juice was, and he had this high-pitched voice. Look at that, he said. Look at that. He said it looks like Jell-O. And he had this very perverse private view on everything. And he was the most influential around the Ferus Gallery at the beginning days. He was the smartest guy. He and Walter Hopps went to school together at Eagle Rock and were exposed to the Annenberg collection and all that. So Craig was way ahead of his time, and he knew New York. He'd been there two or three times and brought back all this information. Where am I on this travelogue?
Do you agree? I mean, Billy Al, for instance, always said that right at the time Ferris was opening in 57, that Craig was making the best painting.
That's right. He was indeed. And he had his first show right after my show. And his father was a judge. And they were very conservative, but they loved what Sonny did. They called him Sonny, of course. And he was making these amazing abstract paintings at the time. And everybody was slightly influenced by it. Altoon, Bengtson, everybody. But Bengtson, a year or so, carved out his own travel with the motorcycle paintings and the lacquer and all that. So he became the major guy. Craig never became the celebrated guy out of the Ferris Gallery. Bengtson was the first. Ken Price was the next. Irwin, when he came in, was Bengtson brought him in. And he didn't know anything about abstract painting at the time, but he learned it very fast. Clifford Still was the guy that he really loved at the beginning.
Can you tell us the process for the resin painting?
Yeah, the process of the resin painting, it was sort of a thumb to the plastic scene. And I like the idea of the way a driver's license or things like that were embedded. So I said, God, I'd like to do that with a painting. Take it off the stretcher bar, put it down flat, and cover it with resin. Well, it didn't work out that simply like I thought it would be like him, the driver. I didn't have the technique to do it. And I was interested in blankets. Terrell actually took me over to Tony Berlant's place, and he said, you're too uptight. I'm going to get you some smoke. So I got high for the first time in 1968, and it was like baby to a bathwater. I love getting high, but I never could be high and shoot pool or paint because I couldn't keep the balls in the air simultaneously. So I only did it as a social thing, but not a working process. I couldn't. It wasn't that I was against it. There was no moral thing about that. It was just that I couldn't keep it together to paint and be stoned. So anyway, where are we on? Oh, yeah. Tony introduced all of us to Indian blankets at that time before he ever started selling them. And I love the patterning and the wharf and the lazy line and all that. So I said, I'm going to make something that addresses that situation, but in my own way. So I took canvas and stretched over wood panels, put a strip of wood on one side and nails of every inch. And I took these snap lines. I always liked the way you take a snap line that a carpenter uses in the little torpedo thing. Instead of putting the chalk, I put permanent pigments. I almost lost my lungs. And I had six or eight with different colors of dry pigments. And I'd pull it across on that nail and snap, and it would make a line. Then I put pieces of masking tape to interrupt, to duplicate the idea of the lazy line. Then I would take a spray gun, or just a flint gun, so that the colors would bleed a little bit. They wouldn't be so mechanical. Then I took the whole the canvas off, made a big Mylar table. I got an outside studio a few blocks from there. And I put it on the table, and I'd take resin, it wasn't that flexible at the beginning, it broke later, and poured it over the back and squeegeed it off to the edge, made gutters like rain gutters around to catch the plastic. And I kept doing them, and I was having the best time doing these things. And then when they would dry, I'd peel them off. You never knew what you were going to see. It was a kind of transformation. So it was a process thing. And I played between process and actually intending to do something. The intending to do something is never as interesting to me as what I discover. So I call myself a visual explorer with materials, not a painter in that sense, although I am identified as paintings. But I think they're sort of dumb to look at them as paintings. They're fallouts from process, and they set up different kinds of patterns or imagery that I have no idea, and so they're all a surprise to me. It's like the Mizuno when it made these lines. I didn't know it was going to do that. That was just the first step, taking the tar paper off the roof and then seeing the projected lines coming through. If you're a kid or in a garage or something, there's a hole in the garage door. I think there was a portrait painter, famous portrait painter, that would set people up with that kind of light coming through a hole and illuminating an aspect of their face and photographing them. So I liked all that, what was happening through the process and the discovery. So then I would try different things. I'm giving myself a lofty term by calling myself an explorer. I just fool around with stuff, try stuff. And when I see something, then I enlarge on it. I become an inventor with what I discovered. Make them wider, taller, round, square, triangle, wherever it goes, I go. I follow it. Anytime I do something with my idea, it's just something I've already seen. I just end up doing stuff that other people have done or I've seen in magazines, like the early abstract paintings that were influenced by de Kooning and Resnick and also Craig Kaufman. So they weren't that interesting to me. But I was with a good group of guys at the Ferus Gallery. And it was a very active, competitive group of guys, very intelligent guys. And they were, we would hang out and compete for the same women paintings. If some collector came to town, some of us never introduced the others to it. I always did. Not that I'm a good guy, it's just that it seemed that's what I did.
So were you selling work at that time?
Little, no one sold much work. The first selling went with Binks and Show, and then Ken Price. They sold, they started selling. Irwin wasn't selling at first until much later when he did the disc and the line paintings, the horizontal line paint. He spent hours looking and getting, adjusting, making a field, making a horizontal line, and adjusting that line. He'd spend hours. And he worked all the time. He was a driven man. I'm a driven man now from 60 on, but at that time, I was not driven. I was just jumping around trying to figure out what I'm gonna do, how to do it. And then once in a while, I'd get lucky. But it was usually watching constructions going. I remember taking the plaster off of a house that I had, and I liked the raw plaster. And I liked the diagonal lasts going there, so I'd leave that open and make cutouts out of that. And so I started making little environments like that. I did one down at Newport Museum when Paul Schimmel was there. I called it the Spider Room. I made these 2x4 walls and covered it with chicken wire and had these spiders crawling all over it. And I was a good teacher of mine, a Buddhist teacher. I said, I've always been afraid of spiders. He says, oh, you have to make friends with them. So I started doing spiders all over everything. I'm still afraid of spiders. Walk in a spider web in the night, I want to jump inside out.
So going back to meeting Walter, how would you characterize them? Did you think of yourself in the first Ferris show as an abstract expressionist, or did you think?
I was an abstract, I was a real painter. I was really cocky and thought I was really doing amazing paintings, so they look like these guys. I was making them better. And I think that's the rationale when people are imitating other artists, that yes, they're drawing that out, but they're doing them even better, which could not have been the case. I look at them now, they're not bad. The Norton Simon Museum has one, and there's another one running loose of those early paintings. And then there was some earlier ones than that that was sort of surreal in a kind of atmospheric where I stained the canvas. I was in to wetting the canvas down and then introducing the painting and then making sharper differentiations of shapes and forms. One of them was called Junior's Rocket. I have to get that back because my ex-wife got it from her mother or brother. Where are we now?
Drink of water.
Drink of water, thanks. About painting, was I asked myself, why am I doing this? What's this all about? Alfie. And I was interested in social anthropology, and I was interested in a guy named Kilroy. Kilroy was a character that left his mark during World War II. It was these fingers over a fence with two eyes, a kind of schmoo kind of character. And underneath it, everywhere he went, then it became a thing that everybody did. Kilroy was here. So what are we doing? We're leaving evidence that we exist. We're leaving a mark that I discovered me. the first self-awareness, I think, of man. Reflection in water, prints in the sand, blood marks on the walls, footprints in wet sand. There was must have been some kind of discovery. At that time, it was just like animal. You give them a stimulus, they react. They don't think. Now some animals have learned. And in early man, and that shift, making hand tools, hand axes. My friend Tony Berlant has all these earliest hand tools. Were some of them what we might call aesthetic? Were they imbued with some kind of magic, some power, and a reference to our own existence? That if I did this with this object, something like this fertility, plants growing, things like that. So I remember I made a trip to Lascaux just before it closed, the cave paintings. And I'd heard afterwards Picasso said these are the greatest paintings that ever been done. We might as well all just throw in our brushes or whatever, because this is it. And these guys went into these caves and laid on their back and made these scaffolding with little oil lamps where there was terrifying things. I'm terrified of the night. I'm always they're gonna get me. I think it's some kind of primal response in my own persona. Terror. People say, well, you seem to be sort of a fearless guy. You don't seem to be afraid of anything. I said, you're right. I'm not afraid of anything. I'm terrified of everything. So terror is my constant companion, not fear. So anyway, I thought what I'm doing here goes back to these kinds of roots. Why am I doing that? So I started making paintings that were just marks. I used these big mops and I would into a wet surface so they would dissolve. I didn't have control. I always like working into wet because if you do a wet brush with paint on a watercolor paper, say, and you sprinkle water on it, when it hits that water, it dissolves. It makes something else. That something else, the other factor in my equation, is apparition, clouds that look like bears. So I like the idea of making paintings that were apparitional, but still paint, just the thing of paint. So you go from the abstract thing, of that term abstract is, anyway, these forms, and then the forms start to look like bunny rabbits or jackrabbits or people. So the play of those two things I liked. And in that play, there's a kind of paradox of discovery. And when they become something else, they become metaphysically powerful, not spiritually. I hate that term, spiritual. It's like I hate the term creative. I hate the term expressive. I'm certainly not expressing myself. I'm trying to find out stuff. The phenomena of existence, the phenomenal world. In the process of this fool doing, moving this pain around, it seemed so absurd until I found some note that I could relate to, that I wasn't just being a damn fool, and I should have gone to medical school, like my mother said at the beginning. Done something, because I loved it. I loved being a surgical technician. My brain cut in. I worked with these great surgeons. They'd let me work with them. And I became the best guy. I ran this whole surgery room down San Diego Naval Hospital when I was 21 years old. So I just had a feel for the feel, like the earliest finger paints, leaving evidence that I exist, that man exists, in response to that, to the first little wall things where there were jagged things and then little patterns and then little symbols. All these kinds of things are my roots. So when I'm doing what I'm doing, there's responses that I exist. Is that important? I guess it is. I often looked at myself in the mirror when I would go by and I asked this shrink friend of mine. He said, that's not narcissism essentially. It's just evidence that you exist. If you notice, you like to walk by and you look in the mirror, not only to see if your makeup is correct or you're not too fat or skinny, identifying your existence. So I came to this thought that there's this collision of these two paradoxical things happening, abstraction and physical world, making pictures of us. And they come together like two thoughts come together. And there's a collision. And if you have the right catalyst, it will ignite it. And both original things lost their identity. There's a third thing that happens. And that third thing is what I'm interested in the painting. Of that phenomenal thing that's outside of me making a straight line, controlling it, I don't want to be in control, I want to be in touch. I told a scientist that the other day. He was trying to figure out something in cancer. He said, we're trying to control this. I said, you don't want to control it, you want to be in tune with it. Once you're in tune with it, then you find out the dynamics. Then I discovered the idea of the black hole, where everything is compressed into this little needle. So dense and so heavy. And that's where the Big Bang Theory, I always thought that was a horseshit idea, that there was the one Big Bang. Then finally, I talked to this guy that can't talk, that's out at Caltech. He talks to a machine, and we had about a long talk. And he had this funny expression on his face, not that he doesn't already. Do you know who this guy is? Huh?
Hawkins.
That's it. And I said, you know, I don't think that's what happened. And he sort of did a thing. What happened is that it turned inside out. When you get all this pressure going in there, instead of it banging out, it turns inside out. So the whole dynamic, the way we view the world, gravity, all these kinds of things, it's inside out. It's not in reverse. Outside of comprehension, outside of conceptualization, is this thought of turning it inside out. And I think that's what happens sometimes in this collision and the metamorphosis. It jumps outside. Once in a while that happens in my work, not often. And that's my search every day. That's what draws me out every day. Today, it's going to happen. But you can't make it happen. You've got to find it through this process of stumbling, falling down, being foolish, being arrogant, all these things that can be in control. Everybody says, I want to be in control, or I want to be happy. What chicken shit thoughts we have. To be happy? But I'd like to be happy.
Okay.
Are you happy?
Sort of now. I get listeners. I love to talk.
We love listening. I mean, a lot of these things that you're talking about in terms of, you know, chance and being in the moment and having these things come together.
Not in the moment. You said that.
I did. But, I mean, you're a practitioner and a student of Buddhism.
That's right. A shitty one, I must admit. Not a very good discipline. Discipline, Buddhists, is you sit every day and you watch your mind. The most difficult thing in the world to do is to watch your mind. You get so restless, and you practice and practice and practice watching your mind. As soon as you have five beats, your mind goes off to a thought. The idea is that you bring it back to your breath. Everything is focused on the breath going out, not coming in.
Did you take part in some of those early tea sessions? I think it was Alan Lynch at Ferris who had the Japanese.
Oh, yeah. Well, Alan Lynch was a good friend of mine. And Alan Lynch introduced us all to the Raku, the tea bowls, the tea ceremony, Kenny Price. I remember Kenny Price. Alan would make a big, elaborate thing of opening the box and the fabrics and laying the piece out. And Kenny Price did that. But he had these old paint racks where he would throw over his pieces. So when you came to visit him in his studio, he would lift them off.
Did you, going back to the fifth, what was your relationship with someone like Berman? What I'm really getting at is, did you think of yourself as one of the beats, or did you think of yourself as a...
Yeah, I was a college boy. I was not a beat. Berman, Craig, and I used to laugh at him and think he was a joke. Walder loved him. Walder wanted a surrealist. He wanted Duchamp. And the closest he could find here was Wally Berman, who ends up being a very interesting artist. And he had this huge following, and they were all smoking pot and doing all the stuff that those guys were doing at that time. And Dennis Hopper hung around there, Dean Stockwell. A lot of other actors were fascinated by Wally Berman. And he did these wonderful little things, cryptic little things. And he was got interested in, what's the Jewish magical Kabbalah, and did these letters and everything all about the Kabbalah. And he had a correspondence with Hermann Hesse. And he was a very interesting, but I didn't know that. I just thought he was a goofball. So there was that aspect. Altoon could play with that, because Altoon talked like a beat guy. And he could just talk in the foulest words in the world and seduce women, tell them he wanted to get on his hands and knees and all this kind of stuff. And they would just, yeah. And he had this following of girls everywhere he went. And we would try to get one of his girls, and he'd run over there and push us off. Then we'd go to that one. He'd do this. So he always had his little group of women. And he was sort of the Golly Jimson of the scene. He was the far-out guy. He didn't bathe. He just lived sort of wild and woolly. And he did these abstract paintings, and it's the last ones he did, I don't know what happened to him, that were fabulous. And then he did his figure drawings of the girls and the scratchy things, and he finally learned just to scratch, and the images came out of that thing rather than drawing them. That was a big breakthrough during the Indian series that started happening. So these are things that you notice. These guys, they make a shift. How does this shift happen? How did Bengtson go from painting to doing this motor? He saw that, and somewhere he had an adventurous thing in his mind that he could do that. And Kenny Price was out of Vocus and made those big, powerful things, and he loved Vocus, and so did Bengtson. But he made them into these apparitional forms with little holes and fingers sticking out of them. He's the most beautiful of us all. All of us were rat bastards. Kenny was a beautiful man. But Wally could have been too, I don't know.
I mean, look at everybody's work that you just named, everybody kind of had a certain type of work, you know, more abstract expressionist, and then everybody had kind of a
they shifted
shift.
And I didn't shift. I was retarded. They really retarded, and they were being very successful, but we all hung around together, and I thought I was doing, and they were very supportive of what I was doing, and but it was outside of that. It was much more personal in these things where I wanted to control. I thought if I put enough, it's like a molar. In the early days, they used to put silver, and they used to have this extractor of some sort, and they'd squeeze it in. You could hear it squeak when it filled. So that's what I was trying to do with these rose drawings and these compulsive lines. I thought if I got it dense enough, somewhere or another I could break through, much like the black hole. So these are kinds of metaphors. Paintings, all of this is sort of metaphors for the way we exist, the way we view, the way we interpret. But Susan Sontag was right. She was against interpretation. Just look, don't interpret. But if you have figures and bunnies, people can say, oh, there's the figures and the bunnies. People that come in and look at painting, it's just so horrifying. And they always want to talk. I said, shut up. Just look. Don't tell me what it means. Meaning, that's the other thing. People want to give meaning to these things. This has to have meaning. It doesn't have any meaning. It's outside of meaning.
Were you going to other people's studios on a regular basis? And
we all exchanged. And we got together at night, and we, Barney's Beanery, Ed Keenholz introduced that. And he was an interesting character. I thought he was a joke, what he was first doing, until he started doing these tableaus. And everybody liked him. I thought they were sort of funky. I didn't like him. He's still enormously successful with these funky tableaus.
Where was your studio early on?
Early, the first studio I had when I first came from Long Beach to UCLA was on the Speedway down near the end over. There was a channel, there was a bridge, and there was this old Indian structure. I rented a room in there. Then later on, I had a little house down there among the oil derricks. I know I went to the city to see if I could buy an oil derrick or rent an oil derrick and build my house up inside of the oil derrick. I thought, God, wouldn't that be cool?
And then you went to New York for a period.
Yeah, then I went to New York in 1958, right after my first show with Ferris. I went to San Francisco, had a show with Deluxe Gallery, Jim Newman. He and Walter were pals. They went to Stanford together. They were going to have these shows back and forth between the two galleries, introducing the San Francisco guys here and us up there. So I had my second show at Deluxe Gallery. Then I joined a pal of mine, and we drove across the country, and I had six paintings tied on the top of a car and went to New York City, and I'd never seen New York. It was just like, wow. What a place. All these kids, dirty kids running around the streets and all this stuff. And then the Cedar Bar, and I met all these guys. And I got in an early co-op gallery called the Area Gallery. It was sort of a second-rate gallery, but it was okay. And I used to go to the Cedar Bar, and I'd meet all the different guys, Franz Klein. I never met Pollock, he'd already died. But I met de Kooning, never met Rothko. And Gottlieb and Stamos, and there was the art club there. And I went to the meetings in the art club and argued and yelled and almost got punched out by Norman Bloom, who was a real tough guy. You punk, he said. And I thought he was going to punch me, but he didn't. I said, you're right, I am a punk.
Describe the art scene there a little bit when you got there, because you said Pollock was dead. Were you aware, like, that was the year Jasper Johns had a big splash with his first
book? Yeah, that was a big breakthrough. And I saw that, and I met him. I met some woman on an elevator going up to one of the galleries, and she asked me to come. She has these soirees, and Jasper Johns and Rauschenberg were there. And she said, I'd love to come by your studio. So Muriel Oxenberg was her name, I remember. And we went over to his studio, and they lived, had studios one on top of the other. And they were so trim. You know, they just had books stacked on the floor, not like this, just piled up, and a cot, and then their studio. And with the goat with the tire around it, and Jasper Johns with the targets and the heads. And I thought, wow, that's really something. That's outside of my idea of painting. And then I went to Franz Klein's studio. He used to take us, I met Chamberlain at the time, over to the five spot where Thelonious Monk was playing. And I'd never seen anyone play like Thelonious, side saddle. And he had fingers sort of like bananas. And he would sort of plunk with them. But he was amazing. So yes, there was that. Fights, different activity. I got in several fights there. And because I had a big mouth. Thank God I didn't get with Norman Bloom. He was a real tough guy, much bigger.
And would you go,
Then I had that, and then I had a little show that Dory Ashton gave me a great review, first review I ever had. And it was a gallery uptown, I forgot the name of it now, Barone Gallery. They didn't last long. And then Sonny was a partner, and then Sonny became a partner in Multiples Gallery that I was in, that I can't think of her now. She shows Gerhard Richter, and she shows all the Marion Goodman. Mm-hmm. And so later on, when she became very successful, I tried to introduce myself to that idea, but she wasn't she was interested in the German painters at that time.
Tell us a little bit about the work that Dory Ashton wrote about.
They were abstract paintings. Some of them, the ones I brought across the country, that I'd done in San Francisco. I had a gallery on 9 Mission where Frank Lobdell and Hassel Smith, they all had names where they'd had studios there at one time or another. Hassel lived later outside of there, but Madeline Diamond, I remember her name was on the same door.
These were the sort of looser gestures before the rose?
Yeah. I was very like that, very abstract and painting all over the place. I don't have any of those paintings. We had a picture. I looked for this one. It's around here somewhere and it lost. And that's when I first, Walter Hopps owned one that I have here somewhere, where I did these very abstract gestural drawings and then would smear them and put paint in them. And then I wrote Moses E. Branco. That's the first time I used that name. And Castilli came to visit me once when I was there and said that, because I was doing these things, sort of abstraction of cartoons, and he heard about it, so he came to Donald Duck and all that kind of stuff, but they weren't literal. They were a little bit about, like Warhol first did some sort of cartoon things and the paint sort of slid down the face. I remember Irving Blum, second time I was living there, and 59 and 60. Irving Blum and Walter came to New York and they were going to see this artist. And could I go? And I couldn't go at the time. Then they came back and said how great and they were going to show him. And that was Andy Warhol. That was 60 or 61. No, 59, 60, that's right. Then I moved to San Francisco and lived there for a while I was married, and then moved to Spain and outside of Amsterdam for a while. That was a nightmare. And then came back here, and I've been here ever since.
Let's talk about maybe a little bit about San Francisco, because you got to know Hedrick and DeFeo and Joan Brown. Talk about that scene a little bit.
Well, it was a big old three-story house, and it was divided in half, one half here. And Jay DeFeo lived up here with Wally Hedrick. I forgot who was, oh, I know, above them was the poet. Michael McClure, he was up there. And then on our side, Manuel Neri and Joan Brown were down below us, and we were up above that. And I remember this, I was trying to make the place bigger. So I was gonna knock out this wall, and I went through this door and I nailed it shut because I was gonna make a hole through to the other side. Or the door got locked. I forgot what happened. I was up on a ladder and I slipped on the ladder. My leg went down in between the rung and I broke my leg. And I couldn't get through out the other side, and Avilda had taken our first baby and she was out walking in the park. So I had to take this hammer and beat a hole through the wall so I could get to the other side. And just then she came in. So anyway, but yes, Manuel told me, he said, Ed, I said, nothing happens here. He said, well, nothing happens for anybody, but nothing will ever happen here for you because we're very biased. We don't like outsiders. You're from LA, why don't you go back to LA? That's where you're known and that's where you'll be. So I moved back to LA, I took his word for it. And Joan Brown was doing goofy paintings that I didn't even like at the time. Now they're not bad. And Patrick Lannan came and took us all out to dinner and he bought a whole bunch of hers, not much of Manuel. Manuel's doing interesting things, much more interesting thing than he ended up doing at the time.
Were you starting to make some of the assemblage work?
Yeah, I did Dalton's Waffle number one there, and I did two and three, but I never made the boxes for them, and they were just newspapers sort of wadded up and filled with glue. Or was it resin? It was clear resin, I guess that was. And I watered it all up and built a frame around it. And then I threw some other stuff in there, but it wasn't much good. Springs out of couches and things like that. And then I did some boxes so big with that oil cloth that I got from Tijuana. And then I painted bigger roses over the top of that, and then had a rose down at the real fake rose down at the bottom. So it was a box containing this thing. I remember Yves Klein was visiting at the time, and I said, why don't you come over to my studio and see what I'm up to? He said, oh, great. I almost killed him, but nevertheless, on a terrible ride, Beverly Glen Canyon, I lived at the time, that's where I had my studio, had a big flood and blocked out with mud going down. So I had to go through Bel Air. And I was afraid I was taking up his time. So I drove very fast, skidded out a couple of times, spun around a couple of times. He was cool as a cucumber. He died shortly after of a heart attack. That was the horrible part of it. And he looked at it, and he was going to put me in a show in Paris of these boxes I was doing, surrealist boxes with drawings, paintings, and objects. They were about so big. Robert Delford Brown has one. I was just thinking, who had one? And Claudia Ransom. So I tried to get them for you, but I haven't been able to run them down.
Okay, well, we can help with that.
Yeah.
When you were in the Bay Area, were you able to attend any poetry readings or?
Yeah, I wasn't into that shit. at all. I thought that they were just a bunch of goofballs. But I went to a few. The best poet of the whole bunch was Meltzer, David Meltzer. He was really good. He was the only one to me that was authentic. The rest of them were just stone and not writing or not saying. They would say things, you know, talk poetry. And I didn't like it much.
And then you ended up coming back to Los Angeles,
yeah,
and really settling here.
Yeah, but I did a lot of paintings when I was up there. I had a couple of shows with Jim. I don't know what happened to any of those paintings. I remember the paintings I was doing in New York. I rolled them up and brought them back, and they disappeared after a year's painting there.
Can you tell us a little bit about Jim Newman and Delexi Gallery? And
Jim Newman was a strange, very kind of shy, withdrawn guy. And he showed all the good people up there and in L.A. Craig Kaufman, he showed. And another guy that died, I can't think of his name, that was part of our group. And but I was sort of isolated from the artists up there, pretty much. Got to know Lobdell a little bit. And he was the best painter by far. And I don't know what happened to him. He never got any feedback, the problem. And I think painters sometimes, if they don't get feedback, they don't do well. Although there's this fantastic painter over at the Hammer Museum that does things from the Middle West. What's his name?
Birchfield.
Amazing, amazing. And he fed off himself pretty much, but he had more activity as time went on.
I was just at the MoCA thing the other night, and the Rose pieces, the earliest pieces of yours,
right,
look really great. And so I think those must have been something of a real breakthrough for you.
Yeah, they were. It was funny. What happened is after that, I removed the roses and just did the drawings, the pattern of the graphite. And I did four. I spent almost a year doing those four. And they were the same height, but without the roses. And I brought them home one afternoon, and I was taking them to the framer in the morning. I had this old Rambler station wagon. And Avilda, my wife, suggested I go pick up the kids in the park. So I took them out and lined them up along the garage. And then they had to deliver other kids. We got back about an hour later, finally. And the garage door was open. And the whole driveway was wet. And Avilda had this guy, I don't know why, hose out the whole garage. And the water percolated up about a third up into the drawings. So instead of cutting it off, what I should have done, I just destroyed them. So that, they never happened, except I have little ones. Well, this is part of a cutout series I did that was sort of an architectural bent. No, those are the all rolled. Here's, is this a solid one? This is a solid. Yeah.
And this one too, right?
Yeah. And these were, this was smaller ones. Yeah. And I'll see what these guys are doing.
So, you know, we've talked all around Ferus, but we really didn't talk about Ferus itself. So first, I thought, you talk about the difference between when Walter Hopps was running it, and then when Irving Bloom.
Okay, I'm going to give you a little history of it. Craig Kaufman came to me and said that Walter was the guy, and he should see your work. And then I had a studio on Sawtelle. Wally Berman was in the front part, and I was in the back part. And he saw the work I was doing, and he said, Walter should show these. So then he got Walter over, and Walter said, okay. So that happened when I was a graduate student. And he and Keenholz had a gallery called Sindel Gallery. It was over on San Vicente. Mm-hmm. It was made up a guy named Streeter Blair. No, what was his name now? He was an eccentric on San Vicente. He owned all kinds of property around there. And this place was built with telephone poles about this big around, stacked up all around it. And that the inside had telephone poles. And I remember the first show was in there was Keenholz and George Herms or somebody like that. And Keenholz would go to the lumber yard and buy scraps of wood. And he would just nail them up on another scrap of wood, piece of wood about so big, just on top of each other. And then he'd go to paint stores and he'd get paint that had been turned in or was they weren't using or any place he could get paint. And he'd just pour that paint willy-nilly over the top of these things. And I thought they looked really funky. I didn't like them at all. Later on, when he had his retrospective, I was really impressed by them. And that was before he started the dolls and the combines and all the different things. So then they rented this building. I think he was Streeter Bear. Spryer Shore was the guy that had the Sindel Gallery. That was the first gallery. That didn't last very long. Then Streeter Blair, who had American primitive art in the front part, and he had a barn in the back. It was just wood, no drywall, nothing. And Walter Hopps set that up, and he had the first show there, the Christmas of 57. And it was a group show, and we were all in that show. And there was a lot of painters, funky painters, all kinds of painters in there. Walter liked it all.
Northern and Southern California.
Yeah. And then he had the merry-go-round show sometime around that time where he stretched canvas all the way around the merry-go-round and had wires and had Frank Lobdell, Clifford Still were wrapped all around. I wasn't in that show. Neither was Craig. It was mostly San Francisco people. I think it was all San Francisco people. And they were hanging from wires in front of the canvas that was wrapped around the merry-go-round. The merry-go-round didn't move during that time. And Craig Kaufman and a guy named Ben Bartosh picked the paintings up in a trailer. And they drove it back to L.A. And when they were going down the hill, the trailer broke loose and went racing down the hill and turned over, and they thought all the paintings, nothing happened to the paintings, some miracle. They got them all back. They stopped to see Walter, who was in boot camp somewhere in around San Francisco. He was washed out fastly. He didn't want to be in the Army. And so he did that show. Then...
opening of that?
Yeah, yeah, it was a great show.
And there was music, was there live music? Could you tell us a little bit about what the opening was like?
There was lots of people. They may have had the music from the merry-go-round, and they didn't sell anything, but they were all big paintings. Jay DeFeo, Sonia Gechtoff, Lobdell, Hassel Smith, all that San Francisco group were hanging all the way around on wires, covering the animals. Because there was a big band around the top, they could hang the canvas down. So you didn't see the animals on the merry-go-round.
Was there live music?
I don't remember, to tell you the truth. I don't remember.
Do you remember Ginsberg or Kerouac or?
No, I remember Dennis Hopper was there. I don't remember if Kerouac was there. No, I don't remember that at all. I think it was just local people there. And Walter then opened behind Streeter Blair, this gallery, and had the Christmas show. Then I had a show there, the first one-person show was my graduate show. Then Craig Kaufman and Bingston and the rest of the gallery people. Irwin wasn't in the gallery at that time, and neither was Ken Price. And then Irving Blum came in one day after it had been open a year or two, and Walter was fed up with it. He wanted to get on. He had been invited to be the director of the Pasadena Museum. So he interviewed Irving, and Irving said, yes, but you have to get rid of three quarters of the artists. Fortunately, I was one of the ones included. And then later, Irwin came on, and Irving was very sophisticated compared to the rest of us because he'd been living in New York. He'd worked at Knowles Showroom. He had this style of talking and personality. And so the show stacked up. Altoon had a show there. And then it moved out of there across the street. And that's where Altoon decided one day that where everybody was a bunch of fakes, including him. And he went into the back of the storage room and cut up all his paintings. And then shortly after that was institutionalized. Was crawling up the wire over at the veterans place where they're all buried, the veterans. Yeah, and he was going over the fence, buck naked. In one arm he had Rembrandt, and the other arm he had the Bible. And they got him going up there. And later on, Laura Stearns and Milton Wexler went and pulled him out and started treating him. So then about 61, 60, Irwin came in. Alan Lynch was sort of around. And one day I said, I knew Patty Four. And she said she wanted to get some photographs. So I rallied everybody up to meet in the back of the gallery. We had this drop paper where we could cut holes and stick our heads through. Irving was dead set against it. He hated the fact that these photographs were being made. And he made the announcement. He made beautiful announcements. And some people were getting disenchanted with him because he started bringing in the New York people, Warhol, Lichtenstein, Stella, and all of that. And Walter had made good friends with John Copeland's. And John Copeland's brought Art Forum down to L.A. John Copeland's did not like my work. He loved Bingston's, he loved Craig's, he loves everybody but me. I don't know if he even liked Irwin at that time. Kenny Price he liked a lot. So they were all reproduced in Art Forum magazines until it moved back to New York. And so I was sort of the outsider in the sense of the imagery that I was doing. They were all very hip with light and space and all of that kind of thing. And I know we all went up, Irwin, Craig, and I, and Larry Bell to San Francisco to see all this technology equipment. They were having a big, and that was about the time they did the art and technology shows. Shortly after that. And we all went up there, and I turned this alternative space I had into these light spaces. And I had light projectors, and I had this ray that's green. What do you call that? I had a prism mirror, these four corners. All the walls were rounded, so there was no definition. And then I had this, trying to think what they call that, a light projection.
A laser.
And I had a laser in one corner, went around the corner and came back and made this green floating light in this room, suspended in the air. It gave the illusion of that. And I did many more. And then I sort of lost interest. was on Venice Beach. I had a building. This woman came to me and said, if you would design a loft for me, you could design a loft for you. So I made twin lofts right there, and I got mine. But she sort of had a crush on me, and my wife did not like that. So she wanted to give it to me, and my wife said, absolutely not, you can use it. So I used it for about 4 or 5 years, and then I leased it out to somebody and never got it back, and finally she sold the building. And it was many layers, so you could have views down in projectors, and I was doing this light and space. That's where I did the resin paintings outside. I had an outside area there. So anyway, that's backtracking again. Why don't I stay in the Ferus group? We all hung out at Barney's Beanery. We were all very competitive, but we had a lot of fun together, and we were critics with each other. I'd go to their studio, and I was sort of the biggest critic. I had the smartest eye besides Craig. Craig would never say much because he didn't want to give them too much information because he wanted it all for himself. And when collectors came in, he wanted them all for himself. I remember Hirshhorn came in one day when I was having the second or third show, and he was buying shows out. And the word was out on the street. So he came into the Ferus Gallery. Did I tell you the story? Oh, sorry about that. I don't know why I have that thing there. That stopped it.
Start with Hirshhorn.
Hirshhorn came in and wanted to buy the whole show out. And it was these figure drawings, these cutouts, and various things. It's a beautiful little show. I said nobody had the right to come in and buy somebody's show out. He could buy three. Well, Walder and Irving and Walder's wife called me incessantly to try to convince me. And I asked Vilda. She said, well, I think you should do what you think is the right thing to do. So finally he got three. And they were really upset. They thought he would not buy any, he'd never come back again or whatever. So he bought three. They're now in the collection, never to be shown again, hidden in there. But I have them in my catalog from MoCA, the MoCA retrospective. So that was sort of the highlight for me, if that's a highlight. But Bengtson was doing these great things and selling right out. And Kenny was. Then later on, Craig was. And then Irwin, then Larry Bell came in, and he was very successful too with his glass pieces, doing great things. I remember he and Irwin and I, and he went to New York. Pace was doing a show of all of us. And we were standing on a corner, and everywhere we would go, people would come up and say hi to Larry. Larry was the kind of guy that was open to everybody. And he said, can you imagine that Larry used to be a student of mine at Chouinard? Now look at him. Irwin later became great pals with Pace and educated him to get a PhD in sight or sound or something like that. And then Irwin did those first paintings with little lines. First he did the Clifford Still, little things about this big.
Little handholds, yeah.
Yeah. And he had a hard time getting started, but once he got started, he was a compulsive, obsessive worker. We shared a studio space, but there was a wall between us. And I'd hear him walking back and forth. I said, Bob, I don't know where you get your discipline to do that. He said, Moses, I love discipline. And he'd do a body of work, and he'd get rid of all the clothes he was wearing, his shoes, all the materials that he used, and he would set up for a new series of work. And he did that, one series after another, completely disciplined, completely focused.
Did you think of yourself working in series? Like, we now retrospectively group these works together.
Right.
But did you think of it that way, or was it just...
No, the series always happened the same way as now, as then. I'm trying different things. And I try it this way, then I try it that way. So I'm left with all of these encounters, evidences of this activity, but not as a series. But then you have a body of work, and then the body of work is exhibited wherever it might be, in a gallery, etc. My first big breakthrough came with the resin paintings. Sold them out like crazy here. Then I was in a show at the opening of the Walker. This guy came out and he picked out one of the resin paintings for the opening of the Walker. Freed, I think his name, Michael. Freed. And Robert Hughes was on his motorcycle, and he photographed them, and he put me in Time magazine. There's a picture of me standing with one of these things. Wow. And Liliana Sonoban came to see the show, and she was going to open up her new space on West Broadway with Castilli, etc., etc. Were in that building, and fell in love with the work, and said, I want to do the opening show. So she did all the advertising, the whole thing for the opening show. And I said, you know, I feel better if we don't do a contract. Let's see how it feels for both of us. Okay. A week before the show is going to open, she sends me a letter with the contract. I was so naive, I didn't have a lawyer at the time. It was against my principle. I've wrecked more things for my future as a professional artist. But see, I said I never wanted to be a professional artist. I just want to do these things. And I don't want to be under the tutelage of what they tell me to do, because I don't know what I want to do. I just want to follow wherever it goes. So I said, I can't sign the contract. So she had her secretary call me, who used to work at Pace, who I knew, and said, you know, it doesn't mean anything, Ed. So I went to Sam Francis. I said, what should I do? He said, remain aloof, don't sign it. I went to Irving Blum. He said, sign it, it doesn't mean a damn thing. I listened to Sam Francis, being obstinate that I am. She says, well, we can't have the show then. I said, the paintings are already there. You've sent me a ticket. I have a hotel. What's the problem here? Just because I won't sign a piece of paper? Why do you care? Because I heard that she controlled her artist, and she'd give them the money she thought they needed, not all the money. That was also a factor in the equation. Anyway, with the show didn't happen. She essentially blackballed me for years with anybody she could. I was going to follow that show and open in Paris, at her gallery in Paris. This guy, Ron Feldman, came, and he introduced me to her. He was going to open a gallery, but he was interested in this surrealist group and Joseph Beuys and all of that kind of stuff. But he had a couple of painters he liked, and he was going to open. So he opened 6 months early. He worked around the clock, and I opened with him and sold the whole show out. Leo Castilli came, everybody. There were two hot shows at that time, Bryce Marden and my show.
And what were the pieces?
They were the resin paintings.
And let's maybe talk about that for a minute, because they're the sort of earlier resin paintings.
Like these.
Like that.
And then I did the laminated paper paintings after that, because I felt the resin was going to kill me.
So talking about the two bodies of work. work?
The two bites. The first was the resin poured on a Mylar table so it would release off. The next I discovered when you put acrylic paints, if they dried on plastic, you could peel that off. So I said, oh. So I stretched polyethylene plastic over a panel, took a crayon, and made these diagonal lines going this way. I wanted to oppose the grid that went this way, rotated it. So it floated, it didn't hold on. Like the grid reinforcing the vertical and horizontal was a grid rotated 45 degrees. And I was also getting away from Bryce Martin's drawings, who I liked. And I was doing earlier grid and hatches and things like that. So then I drew with a crayon, mapped them out, and then I took a stick and with a big brush, I'd dip them in and I'd make diagonals on the polyethylene plastic. Then when I was in Paris, I noticed this toilet paper that was sort of physical and dark and sort of like rag paper. And it wasn't white like our toilet paper. So I bought a couple rolls of that and I rolled that across and then took a paint roller and rolled that with acrylic. So I didn't have enough. So I found drafting tissue that was off-white. It came in various widths. And I went back and forth and sort of wove this grid over the first marks I did. Then when that whole thing dried, I peeled it off. And when I peeled it off, it all came as one big sheet. And they were sort of amazing. And Ron Feldman sold those. And I had two or three shows with him of those. And then Nicky Wilder quit his gallery here. I went from Ferris to Nick Wilder and had a lot of, he was great, and he and I got along very well. And he was selling the New York painters, but he didn't let that get in the way of the local painters. Mm-hmm. Like Irving had a hard time. He worked like a dog, he really did, trying to sell our work. But after the initial imprint, then when Warhol, Lichtenstein, and Kelly all came, he sold those like crazy, relatively speaking. I remember he came to me and he had Elvis Presley, the Six Shooter paintings, silk screen. I'll sell you any of those for $300 or $400, because he wasn't selling any of them. And I tried, but my wife was absolutely against spending any money to buy other people's work. Should be for your work, not buying other. She had a chance of buying Jasper Johns, one of the big targets, and didn't do it, and a little beautiful little green painting he did. But anyway.
Ed, can you tell us a little bit about Nick and Nick Wilder and his approach?
His approach was very loose, very generous. The artist always got paid and he'd be broke. He did that with everybody. And he was just a beautiful guy. Then he quit the whole thing and went to New York and worked for Andre Emmerich and talked Emmerich into showing my work. So I left Ron Feldman to go with Emmerich because that was more of a painter's gallery. And I remember Clement Greenberg came to my show and he said, Clem gave it the green light. You're on your way. So I did the paper things and sold them all out. Ron Feldman's heart was broken. I felt wretched doing this to him. He got rid of his other two painters and he just did what he does now. And it was a big mistake because the next show I did on canvas.
The next show I did was on canvas
with the diagonal bands. With Then I discovered foam brush. First I had regular big brushes, then I discovered the foam brush. And went back and forth and built up the layering of that. It wasn't to see through. People said, oh, you see through these different levels. I was hoping to keep it flat because I was painting. And I worked on the paper and the resin several paintings at a time. Ever since then, I've worked on many paintings at a time, 8 or 10, 20 paintings at the same time, going from one to the other. And so it was a kind of dance. And I remember Sam Francis was out of town. He had this huge space, so he let me have it to work. And I had the whole place filled with these panels with these paper paintings on them. And then the canvas paintings I did up there, too, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, building up density, much like the repetition of the lines. That if you build up the density enough, then it exhumes some kind of power. I never got it through the black hole. I tried. He didn't, I was supposed to send the second set of paper paintings, which I'd done. They were the best ones I'd ever done. But the problem was, to protect them, I'd taken this very thin sheer fabric and paint rolled on to the painting. And then these were the paper paintings. Mm-hmm. And then put this fabric on it. When you push, the idea was just push pin them on the wall. What happens when you push pin them on the wall, the atmosphere would change and they'd contract and they wouldn't lay flat. I said, oh God. So instead I did these, sent the canvas paint. He hated the canvas. Miller was there at the time, and they both, because he had this whole line of people waiting to buy the next series, because the last series was so successful, the next, and they were sold all over the United States. Every museum had to have one, and they went to Europe, and I was a big smashing success. I was on my way, and then didn't sell anything out of his canvas shows. Finally, two. He sent some to a gallery he had in Switzerland, sold a couple there, and I never heard from him again. Ron Feldman wouldn't have anything to do with me. I said, can't we get back together? He said, are you kidding? You broke my heart. Uy. So then I hit the flat zone, and for years, never had much success. A few paintings here, a few paintings there, a show here, I'd sell one or two. And that's the way I've been living ever since that time, is one or two paintings.
I mean, what's odd about that story is that those track paintings
right.
are now some of the things you're known
I know.
Most famous
for. I know, the New York track, they had a couple up at MoCA. And it's perverse. And ever since that time, people never want to buy my current work. Do you have any old work? So I live on old work, never on the work I'm doing currently.
Do you think that's because of, I mean, one thing I think is very commendable about you as an artist, but not very good as a businessman, is that you change.
Yeah, I evolve and I mutate. I say I never change, I mutate. One thing leads to another, it leads to another. And I'm certainly not gonna, just because I've had success out of a body of work, keep doing that. I'm not a career artist. This is not a career. This is my life. So I come from the old thing, well, why were these guys doing this thing? They were later identified as shaman. I would never identify myself as a shaman, certainly not now. But that's the history of it. So if I do it for money, or if I do it for career, then you impact what you're doing. Everything you do is touched by that ambition. And so that's the dangerous thing about ambition. Who was it, Brutus and Caesar said something about you're an ambition. He was an ambitious man. Anyway, not that I'm not ambitious. And not that I don't like money. But every cent I make, it comes back in here. I have a bunch of workers now because of the kind of thing I'm doing. So I just hire people to do it. So every month, I'm right down to a nickel. And something has happened. I've been very fortunate. The gods must be crazy.
Let's go back to Ferus for a minute. The myth now, but it may be myths are sometimes true, is that it was a very tight...
Very trite, very prejudiced. We were the only artist. We're totally arrogant. Made jokes about everybody else. And Irwin and I remember a meeting. We were having dinner. A guy named Bert Berman, who was a friend of Irving's. And I heard, I had been living in San Francisco, and I just got back. And they were talking about Diebenkorn. I said, well, what about Diebenkorn? Well, Irving and Walter want to bring him into the gallery. And Bingston and Irwin blackballed him. I said, what do you mean he blackballed? Well, he copped out. He was doing his figurative. That was the term at the day. Was copping out. If you weren't abstract, you were copping out. So Diebenkorn was doing his figurative paintings. They all deny it now that that happened. I brought it up when we were doing the little film on the Ferus Gallery. Mm-hmm. And that was, I said, well, you guys blackballed. We don't remember any of that. Bingston's, well, it could have, who knows, it could have happened.
Who were you particularly close to and who maybe didn't you get along with so well from that group?
We all got along very well. It was sort of amazing. Everyone was a pal. And I got along great with Bingston and Irwin. And we were all very, it was a really tight-knit group, although we were competitive. That's an interesting thing. But it was us against the world. Us against the art world, against the world in general. And Walter Hopps, right around that time, had a class, an extension class at UCLA, where educated Betty Freeman, Ed Jans, Rowan, all these people were, and created this collector group. But they seldom, Betty Asher, and she saw the Rose drawings, and I heard her and Sterling Holloway was the other one, saying, well, what do you think of Moses' new works? And she said, well, I don't know if I like it. He said, me too. And then years later, I told her something to that. I always loved those works. I said, well, I never saw you buy any of them. I figure that proof is in the, you know, oh, I'm sorry about the misunderstanding, she said.
What was the transition for you from Ferus to go to Nick Wilder?
Nothing was being sold, and everything was about New York, and most of us were bitter. Everybody sort of left, more or less. Craig Kaufman stayed in, and Bob Irwin stayed in through the end of it. Irving was a great guy, and he was very supportive of everybody, but if he couldn't sell you, then what was the point? Nicky Wilder said, great, come over here. And Nicky sold everything I did. I don't know if Irving would have sold the resin paintings and all that. I don't think so. I don't think he would have sold the paper paintings and what happened subsequently. Let's see, what else can I tell you about the Ferus Gallery?
Well, one thing that was interesting to me, we were in New Mexico recently, talked to John McCracken and Ron Davis.
Uh-huh.
And both of them said to us, we were never really LA artists. He said, those guys, they defined what being an LA artist.
That's right, that's right. Ron Davis was very bitter about it. McCracken was very quiet. He's not that kind of a guy, a wonderful guy. But Davis was really upset, and his wife was upset. But he was doing great in New York. And Clem, who was his god, told all those guys what to do, what not to do. He'd go into their studio and take tape and mask out, now there's the painting. He didn't do that with Ron, because Ron was doing these wonderful resin things, and we all liked him, but he was not friendly. He was paranoid, and he was weird. Had these big, weird eyes. But later we became friends. So that was true, that aspect. And all the other groups felt more or less the same way. Lynn Folks was in the gallery for a while, and he was blackballed out. And I don't know, literally blackballed, but no one liked him. And so he's told me for years how much he hated everybody. And the great art critic from New York, Peter Sheldahl, came out, and Bengtson was real rude. Bengtson busted everybody. He played the captain, and the rest of us didn't like it. And
Ed, can you tell us a couple of stories about Walter? You told me, you know, about waiting for him, and then also fired from Pasadena.
Yeah, well, in Pasadena, he'd been taken too much uppers and downers, which he depended on most of his life. He said it wrecked his life. And when Pasadena, when they fired him, they were cleaning up his office. It was a giant office, probably as big as that room, and a carpet covered the whole thing with a desk and the whole thing. So over in this old Chinese building, it might have been in the new museum. And they rolled up the carpet to have it clean, and under the carpet was all his correspondence, all alphabetical. Everything was perfectly arranged. His secretary never knew about it. He kept secrets. They always liked to come up and he'd have a secret. He was like an FBI agent in his personality, and a great storyteller. And he would give insights into your work that you'd never thought about. And he was brilliant at that. Let's see, what was the other story?
The waiting for Walter story?
The waiter for Walter. We decided we were going to do something about the war in Vietnam, I guess. So we got a group of people to meet over at Sam Francis' place. And Jans came and various artists. We got there about 9 or 10 in the morning. About an hour later, Walter called and said he's on his way, he's leaving Pasadena. A couple hours later, he called from downtown. Another hour or two, he called from San Pedro. That was the last call we ever heard from him. And he was typical of that. When he came by your place, it was always 2 or 3 in the morning, because he liked to sleep in the daytime. Shirley Hopps, who was his first wife and then later married Irving, they had a little house in West L.A., near UCLA, near Federal it was. And she thought he'd disappear for 3 or 4 days. He was famous for doing that. And she thought there was mice in the attic. And one day she got a ladder, and there was a ladder. And she went up in the attic, and he had his cot and all his books, and he'd hide out. He'd just go into a depression or whatever it was, and he would write and think and sleep and sleep. Then he'd get up and go out about 4 in the morning, so she didn't hear him. He he'd slip down the ladder and go out to my place or whoever's house he would go. And for exhibits, he would always show up about 1 or 2 in the morning to install an exhibit. He never did it in the daytime. I remember Craig had some beautiful little announcement that Wally Berman had printed on this little print thing. He had a little round thing. Beautiful little things. Craig had done all the drawings for him and the printing and the whole thing. And we went over to pick up Walter to go somewhere about 2 or 3 in the afternoon. And he reached under the bed to get his shoes, and there was the box of all these announcements that were never sent out. And Craig went crazy, tried to choke him to death, and I had to hold him off.
Can you explain Mosesy Branco?
Mosesy Branco. Yeah, my mother's name was Branco. I know Picasso's name, father's name was Reese. So I thought it was funny to say Moses and Branco, E and Branco. And later I made the initials E, B without the thing, and 3. And I did that, and that painting that Walter Hopps, it's around here somewhere. And then Leo Castilli told me that was cool. Yeah, I should go do that. So little by little, I worked up to it. Now I just say, why Branco? And I thought the first half of my life, I would use my father's name, and the second half would be my mother's name. Picasso's name was his mother's name.
Did he become a, Walter Hopps was called Chico.
Right, he didn't like that. Later on, he said, please call me Walter, when he became the director of the Corcoran or something like that. But Chico was his familiar name. Everybody called him Chico. Why, I don't know. I don't know what the root of that name is.
Did you attend some of Rachel Rosenthal's the instant performances?
Never.
Never?
Been always been a fan of hers. I may have seen one thing, but I see her around. I think she's sort of fantastic what she's done. So I give her money or do whatever I can to participate. She's as old as I am.
At least 3 or 4 places that you were one of the few artists that would go to some of the early performances.
Well, maybe I did.
They didn't leave. But last time we were here, you were telling us about, was that with Walter? You did this enormous installation of the Grep, a 40-foot tall of the graphite paintings. Was that in Washington? Did you do that at the Corcoran?
Yeah, yeah.
Can you tell us a little about that?
Yeah, well, that was actually not a graphite. It was the evening before I'd met 2 of the artists. Where can I think of their name? Sort of second level artists out of de Kooning and all that.
Like Alfred Leslie?
And it wasn't that, it was more stuffy guys. And we were talking, and they said they'd love to see my painting. And what I did, the construction based on a drawing, I don't know if that drawing is in here. Of 2x4s framed on the floor, and it was 40 feet high, and it tilted up, and I covered the top half of it with a cutout and painted an institutional green, the drywall, and tilted it up. And so there it was up in the air. And they said, well, where's your painting? I said, there it is. It's a painting to look up to. The only comment I got was from Saul LeWitt during the, plus the director loved it, and Saul Walter loved it. I think Walter might have been the director at that time. I'm not sure. It looked great up there. And I had 2 diagonal braces to hold it from falling over. That was where the tilt-up walls came from. These were some of the resin paintings with the snap lines and the color, but I didn't resin it. Two or three of these I didn't, I just left them and put them on stretcher bars or on panels.
So that's not with the paper, that's just?
That's just canvas. Let's go back to the Ferus Gallery, dig out some more anecdotes that I can think of. It'd be interesting.
Well, some people say that it was a collective. Others, like Irving says, it wasn't a collective, but the artists were part of all the decision making.
Yeah, they did. They did. They gave opinions on things, and sometimes Irving didn't like them, like the photographs we did. They didn't like that idea. And there were two or three things that came up. And then the Diebenkorn thing and the Lynn Folks thing. That was a sad to lose him. And that was a collective decision. I don't know if I had anything to do with that. That might have happened when I was in New York. I left for New York and I spent almost a year there and then went back to San Francisco and then came back to LA.
Were you around when Wallace was arrested?
Pardon?
Were you around when Wally was arrested?
Yeah, that was the first show, actually, in the Ferus Guy. I take it back, it wasn't my show. It was Wally Berman's show. And he was sort of very angry about it, and I didn't understand why. He got so much attention, and everybody talked about this thing. But he left Los Angeles, moved to San Francisco because of that. That's the word out. I don't know if that's true. That was the word. But it was a terrific show. And they went in, that was at the old Streeter Blair place. And they went in and arrested him, and it was based on one little drawing about this big by this woman, Cameron. And it was sort of surrealistic kind of stuff you do on a book in high school or something like that. She's on her hands and knees, sort of abstract with flames coming out of her mouth, and this strange apparitional character is on top of her, like he's butt fucking her. And that was what the whole thing was about. And I remember when Keenholz did his show, he told them that he wanted 20 cents out of every ticket that was sold. And they said, well, we don't do that. At least it was about a third of what the ticket was to get in. And people lined up for blocks because of backseat dodge, that thing. He did one called the illegal abortion. I really liked that piece. That was one of my favorite pieces.
Did you know Cameron at all?
Met Cameron, redheaded gal. Sort of neat. She should have been in the gallery. She and her husband, he was working on some kind of an invention.
Jack Parsons.
Is that who it was? And the place blew up as she was coming back with wheeling the baby. Was he killed in that thing? Yeah. That was before any of the SDS or any of these guys were doing this crazy stuff. I don't know. It was political, or did you ever hear whether it was a political thingy or just a chemistry thingy?
He was one of the founders of JPL.
He was.
But he was also a black magic guy.
Ah, I don't know that much about him. That's interesting.
Did you ever used to go to any of the films that were at the Coronet? Or?
Yeah. Kind Hearts and Coronet. And then there were some art films and stuff.
And didn't Keenholz have an exhibition in the lobby at some point?
He did. Just trash.
So was that?
I thought it was trash anyway.
So would you go to see it? Like what types of films? Was that part of your social?
Yeah, that was our life. We'd come all the way from there up to La Cienega. It wasn't such a big deal to drive up there. I think that was on La Cienega.
And what types of films did you see there?
I don't remember.
You were telling us a little bit about Bankston thinking of himself as the captain.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that sounded...
He acted as the captain.
Right.
Didn't think of himself that.
He
had all the opinions who was good and who wasn't and what was and what wasn't.
And then it sounded like, I mean, Larry Bell hit really big, especially in New York, and that sort of seemed to... Bankston couldn't handle that.
Oh, he couldn't.
Part, right?
Yeah. He just... When he got jealous, he'd say mean things. He had a sixth sense of what everybody's Achilles heel was. And at the right time, depending on how he felt about whatever, he would let one of these things out. And they would just cripple you. I wouldn't speak to him for a year sometime. And he did it to everybody. Irwin finally lost it one day and grabbed him by the throat, banged him against the wall in the studio we had on Mildred and Pacific. And Billy just sort of slid down the wall like a fly being slapped. Because Irwin was intense and strong. And he and Bankston were inseparable. And then that did it. Bankston always had to get everybody in a moment. And he couldn't help himself. It was just part of his persona, and then he would be innocent. He didn't know what he had said. Why is everybody mad at me? Why is Joe mad at me? Or something like that.
So Ed Jans told us we have to ask you about a girl in a watch.
No, Jack.
Jack Quinn.
Yeah.
Oh, Jack Quinn. Yeah, yeah. Well, he gave me this rose-colored Rolex. It's a beautiful watch. And I went crazy for this girl that was so beautiful. And I didn't know she was totally insane. And I gave her this watch. I wanted to marry her, and it was sort of like a ring. And I tried to get it back later. She never would give it back. And he laughs about it.
He told us to ask you. You know, Ed, some of the things that we're kind of working against is the whole dialectic between what was going on in New York and what was going on in LA, and the idea that, you know, New York was the place that there was, you know, a lot of commercial activity and people were selling. But what, you know, now from this moment, what did you think back then about, you know, the difference between, did you feel like you had to go to New York and sell things or?
Yeah, we wanted to be in a gallery in New York, and Bankston was one of the first guys. And I remember Martha Jackson came out, and Martha Jackson met with Bankston, who just was just nuts, whacked out. Irwin was in the other, and she had one short leg, one bad leg, and Bankston had this little footstool, and he ran over and lifted her leg and put it on the footstool. He was just frantic. And he had all these beautiful paintings. And they were the littler ones that went down, and some of them were really great, some of them were just painted. He was influenced by Jasper Johns with the central image, and only he did the iris or the chevron or something like that. And he said that was one of his rules, that you've got to have something that every time someone goes to see your work, they know that's an Ed Moses. That's a billion. So you have to have an emblem, a symbol, and that would always be that. So he did the chevron. And she came, and they had a choose-off between Irving and Walter. And Walter and Irving got all the good ones, and she got all the secondary ones. And she took that show to New York, and everybody put it down, and he didn't sell anything. And he was really upset after that. He hated New York, never show in New York. And they sold all the ones that they kept here for his show.
And so what do you think about...
Come in.
Who's that? In terms of Los Angeles now...
Well, I think we are all influenced and affected by New York, and when they came and showed in our gallery, we were all pretty bitter about it. And we thought we were just as good as them. And when Frank Stella had his show here, he said, Bingston's the most interesting painter I've ever seen. He's great. When he saw his automotive spray painting, chevrons and the motorcycle coloring with lacquer, sprayed lacquer, and he thought they were great. Every once in a while he asked, what happened to Bingston?
That Los Angeles has affected your work in a specific way over the years?
No. I don't believe in California light and all that horse shit. That's just something somebody came up with, and it seemed to work, that we're affected by the light. Well, it's nice to have light and sun and warm. I wouldn't want to live in New York. I went there twice to try to do it. It was too tough for me. The thing about New York, which everybody sort of knew from here, if you go to New York, you can become successful. If you stay here, you can't. And I said, well, why would I want to do that? Is what you're doing is trying to be successful and commercial? No, I'm looking for the magic thumb, right? So the magic thumb cannot be found with ambition. So Los Angeles, there was no support team. There was nothing here. Bingston, again, said, this is Hollywood. This is for movie stars. This is not for artists. Artists are considered secondary, not even secondary. Later on, we got invited to the Daisy and a few places because we were novelties in Hollywood, but Hollywood was the scene. Directors, movie, beautiful girls, and the whole thing. And we'd get the fallout. Ed Ruscha managed the fallout because he's utterly charming and he's beautiful.
But in a way, you're saying LA almost allowed you the ability to make what you wanted to make.
Shake the rattles. You can shake the rattles here. If you go to New York, you're tied into that. It's all set up to be for artists to be successful. Great galleries, all the whole. LA, nothing. So if you shake the rattles and make the magic here, then you're really doing it. That's what I liked.
Did you like, I mean, it's absolutely accurate what you said for time in the 70s, so you and Bryce Martin were the two painters everybody was talking about. Did you like that experience?
Oh, I loved it. See, I'm a paradox to myself. I lie and cheat. I say one thing and actually something else is going on. I would love to be successful. But somewhere or another, my ambition was short-circuited by being a rebel. Like if people are really successful, rich people, I always give them a bad time. I said, here's the power. Just because you have money, that doesn't mean you have the power. For example, of the opening of Mocha, the head guy trustee, when it first opened, came to me and said, Ed, I was stoned, dangerous. I would like to introduce you to Senator Cranston and blah, 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 blah. And I said, hey, Jack, I have to find out who you are first. So he went to my gallery in Louvre Gallery a couple of days later and said, I'd like to see some Ed Moses work. Oh, he's a good painter, I have to admit. But he's the rudest man I've ever met. He did something to a friend of mine, which was him. It's unforgivable. And then, what's his name that runs the gallery?
Peter
called me up to let me know that. I said, well, I've achieved what I wanted to, haven't I? Burned all the bridges. That's the story of my life. Burn the bridges. If you can still shake the rattles and survive, and that's all I do is survive, but I've had money coming in, you know, paying here. Make this building, get loans, do all that. So I've had a very good, really a magical life in a way, because I get to do what I want. And I don't have to be nice unless I want to be.
I think that's probably a good place to take a break.
Yeah, really.